morning, church. My name is Katie Hutchinson, and I am one of the pastors here at Selah Covenant. And I just want to first start off by saying that even though we are called to stay home right now, we are still called the community. As a staff, we've been so excited to see the ways that you are finding to serve the people around you in this time of need. So we encourage you, if you are able to be a resource to those around you, email us at office@selahcov.com. That way we can plug you into those who are in need. And we encourage you as well, if you are someone who needs a little extra help in this time, that you would email us as well at office@selahcov.com or call us. That way we can plug you into someone who can help. As a people, we are called to love God, love people, and live like Jesus. So let's see how we can do that best during this time. I also just want to take a quick second to congratulate all of you and thank you for listening to my challenge. On Easter Sunday, we crashed our website, selahcov.com. Because of the volume of users, our website was literally not working. And first and foremost, we apologize if you weren't able to log on and watch the sermon when you wanted to, but we also want to celebrate the fact that that many people heard the powerful message of the gospel on Easter Sunday. That's a tremendous celebration. But that being said, if this happens again in the future, you can find Selah Covenant Church on both Instagram and Facebook to find the links for the sermon as well. We are so excited that technology has given us a way to communicate and still spread the love of Jesus, even from afar. In just a second, I'll pass it over to Pastor Rebecca. But first, I'm still going to pray over the offering. Even though church looks a little bit different right now, we are adjusting and we still believe that God is going to move and do powerful things. So as we prepare to give of our financial resources, let's pray together as we ask God to do something huge. Jesus, we love you. Lord, we trust that as we loosen our grip of our financial resources, that you will go and multiply them far beyond Selah. God, we trust that even in the midst of this, you are a way maker, and that what we give to you, God, what we give back to you, you will multiply, Lord. God, we trust you, we love you, we worship you, and we give you all of the glory today. In your name we pray, amen.
Hey, Selah Covenant and friends near and far. Welcome to the final sermon in our comeback series. My name is Pastor Rebecca, and I'll be honest, it has been really interesting being a part of this series. You see, the very first sermon that we did in it was right as we had to move everything online all of a sudden. You know, Pastor Scott and I, for weeks before that, had been praying about and getting excited about the series, and then suddenly we were thrust into a season unlike any other. And the need for a great comeback became so much more than just a reminder for our community. Now, as a global community, we are in need of a comeback. This is about so much more than just Selah Covenant Church or the Yakima Valley. More than ever before, I think we are being reminded that we belong to one another, that we need one another to truly flourish, which happens to be a theme that runs strong through the story that I am going to be telling today. So, a while back, I'll be honest, it feels like it was about 3 years ago, but in fact it was 5 weeks, I preached on the beginning of the story of Ruth and Naomi that you'll find in the book of Ruth. And it's one of my favorite Bible stories because it has it all, right? It's got drama and romance and loyalty and death, fear, triumph. It's like the great movies that remind us that we can do hard and even impossible things, which is a reminder that I know I need right now, because it feels to me like we are being asked to do things that feel kind of impossible. You know, these last weeks have felt weird. I don't know about you, but I'm constantly wondering if I'm doing too much or too little, and I'm questioning what the right move is. I've always lived my life defaulting to love, that if I'm not sure of the right decision, if one action helps me to love more than another action, then that's probably the right choice. You know, for an extrovert who loves giving hugs and loves being around as many people as possible, this season of life is taking my whole understanding of love and just like throwing it up into the air. And as it settles back down, I'm finding that the way that I love is looking a lot different. You see, loving in relative isolation is tough for me. I mean, I am not hugging anyone but the two people that I live with. I'm not spending time with a lot of people, and, you know, person to person. I have to fight that voice inside of my head telling me, you know, oh, you should be out there loving people, when really I'm in here loving people. Staying well, helping others to stay well, doing all this ministry online, that is love. It's in a different package than it's ever been in before, but it's still love. It's love that has to sacrifice and do things differently and abandon notions of what love looks like. Now, if I were a betting woman, I would bet that many of you are feeling that exact same strain. Having to stay away from parents or grandparents or beloved neighbors, keeping kids at home and away from their friends, it probably feels like a weird version of love. But please hear me. You are loving people. Sometimes love means giving things up, throwing it all up in the air, and trusting that God is making something out of it as it comes back down. And that is the story of Ruth and Naomi. When everything went wrong, and when nothing made sense, they threw everything up in the air and they walked into the unknown, and God did something incredible out of it. And in the process, they learned something. Something that I believe we also learn on the road to the comeback. Sacrifice, faith, and love. So, as every good epic starts, once upon a time, there was a woman named Naomi. She and her husband had to flee their homeland of Judah because there was a terrible famine, and they settled in a foreign land called Moab. While she was there, she gave birth to two sons who grew up to marry two different women named Orpah and Ruth. Now, as beautiful as her story was until this point, Naomi's story soon became a nightmare when her husband and then both of her sons died. Suddenly, Naomi, Orpah, and Ruth had everything taken from them. Naomi knew that there was no life for her in Moab anymore, so she decided to go back home. And as she left, she told her daughters-in-law to stay and to start new families. She knew she had nothing to offer them. And Orpah eventually stayed, but Ruth refused to leave Naomi's side. In fact, in one of the most beautiful declarations of love ever, Ruth said, "Don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried." And here, my friends, we have the very first lesson that we learn on the road to the comeback: sacrifice. We don't get to the other side of the comeback without some sacrifice. Naomi was right in telling Ruth and Orpah to stay in Moab. I mean, that's where they'd been raised, where they had extended family, where they had friends. It was a land of familiarity for them. And leaving that to follow their mother-in-law to a foreign land, it didn't make any sense. But Ruth knew. She knew that she couldn't go back. She could only go forward. In the midst of her own loss, she knows that life has to change. And so she lets go of what's familiar and she follows Naomi. That first act of sacrifice starts her on the journey to the comeback. You guys, we are all sacrificing right now. Time away from people that we love, time away from jobs that inspire us or keep us financially stable. We're staying at home so we can help this world to heal. And my friends, that is a sacrifice. And so as our story continues, the two women traveled to Judah. And as they arrived, people ran out to greet them. They couldn't believe it. They were seeing Naomi. After all these years, could it truly be her? But Naomi looked at them and she says, "Don't call me Naomi. Instead, call me Mara. For the Almighty has made life very bitter for me. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me home empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has caused me to suffer and the Almighty has sent such tragedy upon me?" You see, Naomi was full of anger and hurt, and all that she felt was bitterness. So she tells them to call her Mara because it literally means bitter in Hebrew. You know, one of the things I've heard from people the last so many weeks is that they don't really know what to feel right now. I say, take a cue from Naomi. Feel all of it. That is what gets us on the road to the comeback. You know, oftentimes when things are hard or uncertain or painful, and all we really want to do is shout, you know, at God and everyone else that it hurts and it's not fair and we're not okay, sometimes we feel bad, like, if we're really committed to loving and following Jesus, we should just be trusting in God, right? just trusting that, you know, God's going to figure all of this out. Please believe me that shouting your anger or frustration or whatever it is that you are feeling in this frustrating time, that is trusting God. God doesn't need our politeness. God wants our realness. Think about your closest people. When you really trust them, you are not afraid to lay it all out on the table, right? So if you really trust God, you have the freedom to lay it all out, to be brutally honest, just like Naomi. That is a holy thing, my friends. To feel all the things you feel and know that every one of them is welcomed by God, because who you are is welcomed by God. We don't get to the comeback by being quiet and keeping it all in. We get to the comeback by being real and letting God in. So I say, make like Naomi and let it all out. But you know what? The story didn't end there. As it continues, Naomi and Ruth settle into their new life, and one day Ruth goes out to the fields to gather grain left behind by the harvesters, and she works hard all day long, and the owner of the fields, a man named Boaz, takes notice. So at the end of the day, he goes to her and tells her to keep gathering. He's talked to his workers, and he's told them to be good to her, and she can hardly believe it. I mean, he doesn't know her, and he definitely doesn't benefit from her gathering grain, so why would he be so kind? Then he tells her, I know about everything you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband. I have heard how you left your father and mother and your own land to live here among complete strangers. May the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge, reward you fully for what you have done. Again, the sacrifices that we make along the way matter. When people see lived out sacrifice, they're changed by it. Boaz knew what Ruth had done, and so he too was willing to sacrifice, losing out on the sale of that extra grain. And here we have the next lesson that we learn on the road to the comeback, faith. That faithfulness is keeping on, when you can't see how any of it is going to work out. So when I was in seminary, we all took one of the hardest required classes our very first semester. I think it was like, hey, if you can get through this, you can get through anything. And when I say hard, I mean that the work in that one class was more than in four other classes combined. It was almost brutal at times. And I remember asking our professor in class one day how we were supposed to get through all of it. And he looked out at all of us and he said in his southern drawl, just be faithful. I'm sure it won't surprise you to learn that that was not quite the inspiration I was hoping for. And wouldn't you know it, the rest of that semester, whenever we asked how we were supposed to get the next thing done or pass the next test, guess what his answer was? Just be faithful. In fact, for the next 3 years, anytime I talked to him about any challenge I was experiencing, he said, you guessed it, just be faithful. And then as he stood in front of my graduating class with tears in his eyes, he said to us, my friends, you've been so faithful. Do you get it now? Here's the deal. Faithfulness doesn't mean blind belief. It doesn't mean lack of doubt. It doesn't even mean being at church. Faithfulness is when you keep going and you keep working and you don't know how any of it's going to work out. And that is exactly what Ruth did. She was faithful. When she didn't know what was coming or how things would work out or if her efforts would lead to anything at all, for months she showed up to gather grain and take it back to Naomi. And then one day, Naomi gave her a challenge to ask Boaz to be their family redeemer. Basically, an ancient way of saying, hey, ma'am, you're a good guy. I'm a good woman. How about you and me marry, and then our families will be taken care of? Of course, if you read the whole story, and I highly recommend that you do, you'll see it was actually a little more complicated than that, full of all sorts of complexities. But since this is a sermon and not a seminary class, we're going to be moving right along. Boaz is impressed with Ruth's faithfulness, with her virtue and her strength, and eventually they do marry. And as happiness would have it, Ruth ends up becoming pregnant and gives birth to a son named Obed. If any of you out there were wondering what to name your next son, you're welcome. As the story comes to an end, Naomi cuddles her grandson and takes care of him. Her life has come back to her. When her story began, everything was death. Even the possibility of becoming a grandmother had been taken from her. And then we have Ruth. Her life has come back to her. She has a husband and a son. Both women began this story in death, but they've ended it in life. And now we have that final lesson that the comeback teaches us. It teaches us about love. And that it usually ends up looking a lot different than we think it will. And that in the end, it actually is all that you need. Think about it. It was love that inspired Ruth to leave everything she knew and follow her mother-in-law. It was love that led her to sacrifice. It was love that led her to faithfulness, showing up and keeping on when she had no idea if or when it would all work out. It was love that made Boaz the family redeemer, and it was love that brought new life to a story filled with death. And do you want to know the best part? Ruth's son, Obed, would eventually become the grandfather of King David, whose direct lineage led to the birth of Jesus Christ. That's right, folks. It was Ruth on the road to the comeback, learning about sacrifice and faith and love that eventually led to the birth of Jesus, the greatest comeback ever. And we believe in the God of the comeback, which means we can know with absolute certainty that the comeback is on its way. And even better, it's not for me or just for my family. It's not just for our community. This comeback is for the entire world. And like every great comeback story, like Ruth and Naomi, we won't go back to what life once was. No, we are going to be stepping forward into a new life, into a transformed life. So here's the challenge. What are you learning right now about sacrifice and faithfulness and love? Let us know. Or even better, let the world know, because we all need to hear from one another right now. We need to hear the lessons being learned and the reality of where people are at and how they are being transformed in the middle of all of this. We are on the road to the comeback, my friends, and it is quite the road. But hey, we're on it together. And that's how we're going to get to the other side. Together. Let's pray. God, you have made us to do hard things, but you promise us that we don't do those hard things alone. In fact, you have promised us again and again, and we see it story after story, that you always do the hard thing before we even have to attempt it. So God, as we sit here in the midst of feeling a lot of stuff, uncertain, feeling maybe afraid, maybe feeling hurt or lonely, God, would you continue to give us eyes to see the joy? Would you give us hearts to know how you are in the midst of all of us, of all of this, Lord? For those who are lonely, would you give them peace? Would you remind them that they are not alone? And God, even now as we're wondering how we can go forward and what we can do, how do we love and serve your people? God, remind us that our sacrifice is a service. Lord, remind us that faith is showing up in whatever way we possibly can, even if it means we have to stay home to do it. And remind us that your love, God, it never looks exactly the same way twice, and it never looks the way we think it's going to. But it is so real. God, in everything we do, in the things we say, even in the things that we think, would we look a little bit more like you today, tomorrow, and every day? Lord, we love you and we give you this time. Thanks for being here with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you know, folks, that is just about it. But there is still a chance for you to win some gift cards. So I need the first two people, the first person to message us through Facebook and the first person to email us at office@selacove.com. So we're doing email and Facebook this time around. Answer these two questions at the very beginning of our story. Naomi said that she wanted to be called something different. What name did she want to be called? And about halfway through our sermon here, no fair looking at it again, I told you that I had a professor that repeated one phrase over and over again. What was that phrase? Okay, You have your two questions, answer them, message us, email us. And if you want to just tell us other things about how your life is going, you know what? We would love to hear it. I hope you all have a fabulous rest of your Sunday and an incredible week ahead of you. Let us know how we can be loving you and praying for you. And just know this, we really miss you. And we think you are the best. So thanks for being here. Bye.